Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world on the internet, thanks to the marvel of technology, I am coming at you live from my little guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard, and you are listening to Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Unfoldment and Reinforcement. Radio for the soul. We are beginning to move well into the window of 2017. Just before the new year, I asked Spirit to help me find some time travelers, and now they're coming out of the woodwork. Today, I have a very special guest with a very special story. We'll get to that shortly. Go and check out the new Center of Light Radio website. It was inspired by a mystical experience I had one night. Once you arrive at the website on the opening page, you will see a subscription form. Fill it out. It'll give you access to my monthly newsletter, which I put a lot of time into finding the most amazing, empowering information that I can find. If there's something in particular that you would like me to do the research on, I would be more than happy to. You can contact me at KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. I will chase that rabbit into the hole as far as possible, and I would be glad to incorporate that into the Center of Light Radio monthly newsletter program. I love empowering people. That's my gig. That gift was given to me some years ago, and I love paying it forward. It's my life, actually. Also, let me tell you about this new program I have released to the public just a short time ago. It's called Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. On the opening page as well, you will see a red Ferrari. Click on it, and it will take you to my lifelong work. I am absolutely confident that this program will expand your life into greater degrees of the bliss that you desire and deserve. If you're a YouTuber like me, which I love, I find lots of good information there. Go to YouTube and find Center of Light Radio. Subscribe to the page, like any of the video archives you see there, and leave me a comment in the box, and as well, while you are there, give me a thumbs up. This helps me to gauge future guests, and if there's any field in spirituality, anything outside of the box, basically, that you would like me to have a guest on the show and that they represent that which you would like to hear more about, let me know what that is. I'd be more than happy to look further into that for you. Services. I do speaking engagements and have for many, many years. I have given life-changing presentations on spirituality, the divine incarnations that have come to Earth, are on Earth now, and will be coming, also as well as extraterrestrials and my experiences with them. So basically, I can cater to anything that you may be wanting for me to come to speak about. Spiritual readings. I tend to stay away from the word psychic. That's dangerous ground for me. But what I would rather say is that I can offer you perspective. If there's something that you want to make a decision about that is a big thing in your life, if you're needing clarity, I promise you, within an hour, I could bring you to explosive clarity. And finally, removal of dark entities, ghosts, spiritual squatters. If you have beings in your house that are not paying rent and causing you nothing but trouble, they need to get out of there. And I come with an arsenal of light, high vibrational information that will change the vibration of you and your home. And that way you can bring everything back to the state of peace that you are wanting for your family. I absolutely guarantee it. And I will be in it with you all the way. I will not just hand you the information and split. I will be in it with you all the way until the goal of peace in your home is achieved. Now it's time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Today, I have a phenomenal program for you. The Kenneth Pass story. The title of this show is called Taken, A Child Time Traveler. This show is about someone I recently met through social media who has this most amazing, amazing story to tell about being picked up as a young boy when he was on a camping trip with others and brought back 10,000 years or so, stayed there for 2 years, and then was brought back. He presented his story to many of the higher-ups in ufology and MUFON, these type of people, and was ridiculed. No one wants to take his story as legitimate. I gave Kenneth my ear recently, and he grabbed my attention. And I told Kenneth that Center of Light Radio would be more than happy to offer him the platform so that he may express himself as well as tell what happened to him and about five or six other people on this camping trip when he went on the hike. So now, without any further ado, welcome to Center of Light Radio, Kenneth Pass. So Kenneth, I can't think of any better way to start this program than to let you just start from the very beginning of what happened to you when you was a young boy.
All right. Well, I went to a camp in Mendocino County, California back in 1982. I went on a 50-mile hike with a few other people. We were we had to sign up. We were kids. We signed up. We were three boys, one little girl, two men staff members, and a female staff member from this camp. And so we set out on the first day. We walked. We must have walked at least about 10 miles, just about. Wow. It got dark, and yeah. And well, that first night out, we got abducted onto a craft, and we received implants by extraterrestrials. The staff members were banging, screaming, "Let us out, let us out." They were inside of holding cell cubicles inside the craft.
So when you guys were abducted, it wasn't like you blacked out. Next thing you know, you wake up and you 2,000 years in the past. You were aware for this ride.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So were the other staff members and the other children.
I can't begin to imagine the terror that would come over someone.
Well, I wasn't really scared. The staff members were screaming and yelling. Us children were calm and casual. I guess they had a control over us. I wasn't afraid. I thought everything inside the craft was neat.
yeah, right. Dig it.
You know, and after the implants and everything like that, we got taken back in time on the craft.
And so you went back a couple of few thousand years, yes?
Yeah, we were taken back in time thousands of years. I'm saying at least 10,000 years. Because we were with the ancient Pueblo, and they were weaving baskets. So this was in Nevada, what is now called Nevada, in what is now called the Valley of Fire in Nevada. They were just weaving baskets, and when we first met them, it was late at night, and they were cooking on a fire. They were cooking a coyote dog. They had the meat from the coyote dog. It was dead. It was laying on the ground, and they had the meat in the fire, and they were cooking it. Basically, the craft dropped us off and took up, and we were stranded back in time.
So, Kenneth, because of this event of you and the others being taken, when you were dropped off, did they just drop you off and took off, or did they hang around? Did they come back and make visits, or what?
Basically, they did. They did check up. I was taken to different time periods in time on the craft because I had my implants, and they were following us. They were basically hunting us. They were wanting the experience too, I guess, you know. And
so that was going to be my next question. Did they ever impart to you the reason why they would just pick up the lot of you and just bring you back thousands of years and just drop you off and say, you know, have a good time. We'll see you next week. I mean, do you know bones to bones why this took place? What was the purpose?
Well, basically, after I got my implants, when I was inside the craft initially, when we first were abducted, I was sitting at a console with a whole bunch of buttons. And what's a kid to do inside of a craft with a console with a whole bunch of buttons?
You're right. Don't push the red button. Well,
I was pushing a lot of buttons. I was part of the collective. Being a part of the collective inside the craft was kind of like a busy office where everybody has their back turned doing their work and no one's saying nothing. It was kind of like that. And I was pushing buttons, and the next thing I know, the door opens up and I run outside, and it was late, and seen a fire and ran to the fire. There were people sitting at the fire, and these people were wearing animal skins and they were cooking coyote dog, and the other staff members ran up because we all were released. And, the lady staff member freaked out. One of the guy staff members says, "Do you know where we are? We're back in time." And the craft took up.
Who were these beings? Did they ever reveal the name of their race?
I never really asked.
What did they look like? Did they look like the typical gray or?
Well, they kind of look like a typical gray, but they have like a grayish, like an elephant skin. And they have the big eyes and everything. I got a picture of them on the site that I posted for everybody to see.
Sure. We're going to get to those images, listening audience, here just a little bit. And make sure you go, why not go there now? centeroflightradio.com/time-traveler. You're going to see some images, and a little later in the show, Kenneth is going to tell us what all these images are about. Kenneth, I remember in one of the conversations that you and I had, you told me about this box cube. Can you tell me a little more about that, please?
Okay. Well, we were taken to an underground cave where I was made to get some kind of like a box cube. I had to jump over these big box cubes to get to the smaller one in the back of this underground cave. There were four tall grays that were wearing robes, and a shorter one with like an elephant skin. And they said, get the box, go get the box. So I basically told them no, and they kept on saying, get it. So I eventually jumped over these bigger box cubes to get in the back of the underground cave. There was a hole cut out in the top part of the portion of the cave, and two of them were watching me the whole time do this. And I got the box cube. It's no bigger than it's about the same size of a Rubik's cube. You know what a Rubik's cube is?
I do.
Well, it's about the same size as that, same shape, except it's not a Rubik's cube. It's extraterrestrial technology.
Was it made of anything that might be familiar here on Earth? Was it metallic? Was it wood?
It was like a metallic rock metal, like a rock metal.
Yeah.
But with the purpose of these box cubes is they can hold your soul.
Say what?
Inside of a box cube.
They can hold your soul?
Yeah, inside of a box cube. And I eventually, and later on, I hit it. I know exactly where it is. I hit it.
Did you hide it as leverage?
No, I hit it because I was messing around with it when I was a kid, and I was inside the craft, and I got my feelings hurt by the extraterrestrial. He said I could have it, and then basically he was going to take it away from me. So I got my feelings hurt, and I was crying, and I ran outside of the craft, and I hit it.
Ah, I see. So when these beings would communicate with you, did they have any verbal utterances at all, grunts, snarts, anything? Did they speak, or was this all telepathic?
Telepathic.
And so could you hear their thoughts all the time if they are of a hive mind kind of communication? Were you able to, and privy to just being able to tap in and hear everything that was being exchanged, or you can tell they were blocking you out of certain conversations?
Basically a block. It's only kind of like what they want to tell you, what they want to share with you, and basically whatever you say, you know, goes through. But they can block that out too. So
wow, I'm just trying to wrap my, and I'm a pretty expanded guy in my thought system, and by no means am I doubting your story. It's just a lot for anyone, even for you as a kid, and these people that was all taken to this different time reality to probably have the wits about them, say, my God, is this really happening? Were these beings, and I remember the conversation you and I had a couple of weeks ago, you said they were nice to you, they were okay with you, but by nature, were these particular beings benevolent or malevolent, or was it a little bit of both? I mean, what was your feeling about who they were?
Well, considering that they did abduct us and they did do things to us on tables and stuff like that, a little bit of both. Because I didn't give him permission to remove my eye or have something implanted inside my mind through my nose and the back of my neck.
You mentioned that to me. What was the purpose? Did they tell you? What was your intuition? Why would they take out your eye?
I don't know. I really don't know. I was just a kid.
I understand. Yeah. Kenneth, I don't mean to be personal, but have you found some peace around this?
Basically, I know I did something wrong, and with the alien technology that I hid, and also to the fact that I've died back in time. I fell off a tall rock mound, and I died, and I went to heaven before my natural childbirth. A great transcendence happened thousands of years ago with me. I also got pictures of myself in heaven, and I know many people were thinking, well, how does he have pictures of himself in heaven? I have pictures of my younger self in heaven thousands of years ago in today's time period. A sort of spiritual time paradox happened with me. I got all the proof of this. I got all the facts. This is the real big stuff.
This transcendence you're talking about, is it because you died physically before you were ever born? Is that what created some sort of burst of a doorway opening up? And what was this transcendence like, Kenneth? Not only the once you got to, quote, heaven, and I want to talk about what that was like for you and why you're using that word heaven without judgment, of course, but what was the actual transcendence process for you? What happened?
Well, when I opened up the box cube and I let something out, I died. And at the same time, I was up on the cliff, on the side of a cliff rock mountain, and I fell. So then I was in heaven, and then I fought a great evil with many in heaven. I got the pictures of that, too. I got the pictures of the evil. It's not very good. I can tell you that right now. I posted it. You're going to see these pictures. You're going to see them. You just have to look into them, and you'll see, and you'll be like, oh, my gosh, this is real. And I'm like, yeah, it's real.
Do you think that what you let out of that box cube was a soul that was captured?
Yes. Yes. I actually basically just, excuse my language, but I pissed it off.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm sure they probably thought it was you that put it in there.
Well, it wasn't me.
Right. So, Kenneth, tell me a little more about this heaven that you describe. You know, most spiritual people see heaven as Jesus and, you know, sitting on a park bench and the lions are laying down with the lambs and, you know, what next? You know, but what is this heaven that you described? And are you using that word meaning literal scriptural heaven or just a way of describing the plane of existence that you were on?
Basically, excuse my language, but what white people don't know is that heaven is in the clouds. That's the spirit world, really, really big. It's right above everybody. That's where I was, and I got pictures of myself in heaven. I got pictures of me in heaven with many great spirits, many bad spirits. It's another part of life. It's like saying like this, there's life in the soil. There's life walking on top of the soil. There's life in the water. There's life right above our heads in heaven. Jesus was pointing towards up, towards heaven in the clouds. Everybody thought heaven was just like, you know, something else, but it's not. Heaven is in the clouds. It's in the spirit world. You can ask any Native American also, where's heaven? You'll be like, there's heaven right there. It's sure. In the spirit world.
So when you were then, you said you would... In this time locale for what, 2 years, give or take?
Yeah, I was back in time for two years, thousands of years ago.
So you were definitely under the age, you were definitely under a teenage age. When you were there, what did you learn? I mean, was there, did you sleep in a cave? Did you sleep in teepees? What did these Native Americans teach you? Is it all foggy? What?
Well, basically, I remember a lot of stuff. What you guys call now today pit houses. They're underground houses. And we slept in one of those one night. See, we were traveling, so we didn't get to really stay for any one place for too long because we were something was happening with me. Something was happening with the other hikers. I mean, you got to be realistic. We were people from out of time. There was no people like us. There was no white people on these lands thousands of years ago. We were wearing jeans. We were wearing jackets, tennis shoes. We spoke English. There's also myths and legends about us. And I'm one of these people that's now grown up. I'm one of these star people that came from the star inside of a craft. But I got proof of also why that the ancient Pueblo went to the cliff sides is because they were being hunted by other groups and also because to protect themselves from the star beings because they were taking men, women, and children. They were taking people. They were abducting them. It hasn't stopped. And today's time period is no different. It hasn't stopped. They're still abducting people. They've been doing this for thousands of years. They're time travelers. These crafts can time travel in time.
So if you were with these beings for 2 years, And I know that being such a young boy, you told me you didn't want to reveal your age, and I respect that highly. But let's just play with a number. Let's say between ages of 7 and 9, or whatever it may have been. I understand that the awareness a child of that age has is to a certain level. Do you know that you were gone for 2 years, or does it seem like your best guess? And if you were gone for that length of time, what were you doing all this time other than just sitting in a seat, pressing buttons and flying around and checking out new realities? I mean, were you getting off the ship, eating? I mean, how did you survive? How did you eat?
Well, basically, we were given a mother and a father of Pueblo. They took us to all these places that are now called the Star Cities, and also to a place in the Grand Canyon that people call today the ancient lost city of the dead in the Grand Canyon. We were there before the great flooding of Earth. We were also there with the ant people and a lizard person. The lizard person was smaller than the same size as I was and wore armbands. And everybody's had belts tied around their waist really, really tight, kind of like rope belts. And there was to be no greed over the food. And something happened in the sky, and a big explosion or something, and the waters came, and we all rode out the giant flood in the underground city. And then the ant people woke up. They looked kind of like praying mantis ant people. They woke up, and they were taking people, too. Then we were inside of we went to a cave room. We were rushed to a cave room where I was told to sit in front of this little carved out picture inside of a wall in the underground cave. And the elders were arguing with the other elders. There was a big fuss and everything like that. Then we went into the cave room, and then the doorway collapsed behind us. And here's what I thought was really trippy, because I never seen nothing like this happen before in my life. And I was witnessing it, and the other hikers were there. My father in chief, he made a tree root grow into a full-fledged tree in the underground city in our cave room, punched a hole, made an opening outside, and we climbed out instantly.
Wow. So these lizard people you were describing, would they possibly be the reptilians or the Dracos, or no, that's two completely different races?
Kind of like a servant, I guess.
Mm. And so these different races, the ant people and the lizard people, were they able to get along? I mean, were there sense of unity there?
Well, actually, to tell you the truth, there was people from China. There was the ancient ancestors. Of a Pueblo in Hopi. They were in the underground city as well. We were in the underground city. But see, here's the part that's different. All my elders, because I was a kid, all my elders, they all had these tablets. Some were made of jade, some were made of stone, some were made of these many thin sticks tied together. But, excuse me, they all had a religion on it. They all had words I'd never seen before. And I was looking at them, and they were protecting them. A lot of religion was in the underground city, and a lot of people from different lands. And there was the grays, the ant people, the lizard, the Chinese. Everybody was in the underground city at one point because of the great flooding.
You know, it would make sense to me, because when you and I spoke a couple of weeks ago, you had mentioned to me that, well, obviously, if it was that long ago, there would be no buildings and there were no aircraft. And you said that the skies were full of extraterrestrials and craft, because it was a different time back then as to why they could flood the earth, so to speak. And I didn't mean that with water, but make their presence known. Because if they were truly part of our genetic makeup, or if they had any role in the evolution of the human species, it would make sense that they were prevalent and always abducting people, though it may not be a fun process. If that is the will of Creator, that how humanity is going to evolve by manipulating certain DNA, it would make sense to me, as you had described, why so many people were being abducted.
All I know is when we got there, there was many elders. They were still digging out parts of the underground city, and I helped make the seashell art. There's seashell art in the underground city. And no one knows this except for me, unless the Smithsonian's been in there, which I'm pretty sure they have. But I made the seashell art in the underground passage on a big doorway on the left side. And I gathered many seashells, and I worked really, really hard on that. But they were still digging. Everybody was preparing. They knew that something was going to happen. And we got there just in time because it happened.
Right, right. So, Kenneth, is there anything more you would like to tell us about this particular, about the experience of being taken and brought and left, how you survived? What happened with all that before we move towards the picture portion of the show?
Well, all I want to say is I got to see Earth, what Earth looked like a long time ago, and so did the other hikers. I've been trying to look for them. I haven't found them. I don't know if I ever will find them.
Were they brought back? Or do you know they were left or brought somewhere else?
They were brought back with us. We were all brought back. We kind of finished the 50-mile hike after. But we got to see what Mother Earth looked like a long time ago. And it was beautiful. And what's happening today is very wrong.
Compared to what you're describing.
You could drink from any stream of water without worrying about being sick. There was animals everywhere. There wasn't water in many places. So we had to really, really conserve. And some of us, we even had to drink from each other on these long journeys that we did. And that's basically saved our lives.
When you were with these other people, the people of your group, your camping group, you did have time to hang out, be with them while all this was taking place, be it with the Hopi, being it at this location?
We did everything together. We were a giant family together. You know, that's what being a part of life was a long time ago.
How long did it take for everybody to normalize? So if that it would be even possible, how long did it take them to normalize to where they accepted their fate? Like, you know, this is now reality for us, and start working into, the family unit that you're describing. I mean, the adults, I'm sure. I mean, like you said, kids a lot more resilient, pushing buttons is fun. But adults, I mean, how long did it take for them to find their center and make sense and find some peace?
Basically, we didn't really understand the language because we were coming across many people. So we used body language, and we used to write on the walls, on the rocks. And you also see us holding hand in hand on many of these petroglyphs. They're called petroglyphs. And we're hand in hand. That's us. We were recorded by the elders thousands of years ago. We were basically, excuse my language, but we were pretty much all scared shitless.
you think? Yeah. I can understand that. Center of Light Radio. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host, Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Today, my guest is Kenneth Pass. Kenneth was taken as a young boy to thousands of years back in time. He's a child time traveler and was returned from a camping trip. He and a group of people went on a hike from a summer camp, I believe, or something to that effect. And Kenneth and this group was brought back. Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. when you were brought back, Kenneth, were you brought, you were brought back right to the hike? Yes.
Yep.
Like, sure, like no one would have ever missed you.
And one of the elders came back in time with us too. He was more like my brother. The last time I seen him was in 1982, Mendocino County, California. He was wearing his bone knife. He had a bone knife, his animal skins, his little pouch tied around his neck, and pretty much that was it. He was pulling towards us, and he grabbed me and said, basically, let's go. And I knew where we were going. I'm pretty sure I knew where we were going. It's just that I didn't remember him at the time, and we pulled away from him, and then he ran into the woods, and that's the last time I seen of him.
You remember where you hid that box cube?
Oh, yeah, I can take you right to it. It's the only problem is trying to get there. I don't have no resources to travel to go anywhere. I'm older.
And this, do you think because of all the time that has passed, the weathering, the erosion, the changing of the earth, the shifting, you think it's still safe where you put it?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Wow. Yeah. Do you think you still have that implant and they're waiting for the day that you strap your butt in a car and start heading out west so they can track you and follow you to see if, where you put this thing? And if, here's the thing, this is my question. And again, this is not a disbelief in your story, Ken. It's a very honest question. And that question is, if they are of hive mind and they are telepathic, how is it they can't read your mind to go find this box cube?
When I was working over here where I live at, I had to deal with a lot of magnets. And magnets make my implants hurt really, really bad. And then, 2014, I just said, forget it, I'm going. And I got in my head, I had a little money. I got in the car that I had, and I hoofed it all the way there. And it's still there. And when I got there, there was a great war in heaven. I was up in heaven. The extraterrestrials were in heaven. And I was on the earth, and a black helicopter, Army Black Apache helicopter, buzzed me. And I was like, whoa, so everything, everybody still remembers me, huh? Well, how come no one wants to help me do the right things? Basically, I got scared after I stayed there for a couple of days, got many pictures, and I came back here. And been out here ever since, stuck. You know, I should have did the right thing, but I didn't know that much because I was still waking up to the fact that all of it was real and it really wasn't a dream, that these things were recorded on petroglyphs. I was recorded. I have pictures of myself in heaven. This is reality. This is what it is. And I do need help from these top wig, these top ufologists. I need them to get off their ass and help me for once. Because if they want the biggest proof and the disclosure that they always wanted, well, I hid alien technology. I have pictures of the extraterrestrials. I got pictures of everything. I was recorded by the elders on petroglyphs with the other hikers hand in hand, and were also recorded on Prophecy Rock in Arizona hand in hand. That's us.
So, Kenneth, when you were brought back, did you have your memory intact? Like, oh my God, they just dropped us back off, and your awareness and your memory of it all stayed with you? Or was this a process that was blacked out and slowly but surely this full and total recall began to seep its way back into your experience? What was that for you?
We were hazed. We were made to forget. And plus, I was really hazed really hard because I had also died back in time, and I probably couldn't have handled it, you know. But I did handle it all through the couple of years that we were back in time with the elders. They took good care of us, you know. We went through some bad patches with some bad people, but, you know, they seen that we were different. We were on a path, and they didn't really bother us too much.
So, Kenneth, you want to head over to the website and look at some of these, go through some of these pictures, so we can tell the listening audience what all this is about.
Sure, I'm right there, right now, looking at it.
Okay, listening audience, go to www.centeroflightradio.com/time-traveler. Once again, www.centeroflightradio.com/time-traveler. We're looking at a page, a bunch of blue sky. I thought that was appropriate for what this is all about. Kenneth, on row one, first picture to the left, what is it that we're looking at here, sir?
You're looking at an extraterrestrial in heaven, a real extraterrestrial in heaven. You have to probably stand back from your computer monitor a little bit to see. But you see, I only had half the image. So I used the mirror effect to complete the image. And when I did, you're looking at an extraterrestrial in heaven.
And there was no manipulation whatsoever. You just took a picture and you mirrored it. And that's what we're looking at.
Yep, basically that's it. And that was phenomenal. In the Valley of Fire in Nevada.
And not only do I see a face of an extraterrestrial, I see three faces. I see the actual initial big face, and then where the eyes are, there are two smaller faces.
Yep.
Did he have a name?
I don't remember. I was just a kid.
Was he the head honcho?
Probably. He's probably the one that put his hand on my back in the underground city, and I shrugged it off. I shrugged off his hand because, you know, he was different, and I didn't really understand. I was just a kid, and, you know. But if I was there, like today, I really want to ask him a lot of questions. You know, I still have questions I want answered. You know,
I'm sure. So Kenneth, this figure, this archetype, this real person, whatever the reasons that these images are appearing to you in the sky, what, if there is any at all, what would be his role in your life? Do you think that he knew you were a young boy? Does have some sort of compassion. Is he a guide for you, watching over, implying this picture?
Guide and elder, yeah. I mean, I was just a kid. You get to remember, I was just a kid, and all the grown-ups, they were doing things and, you know, freaking out too and stuff. And I was just a kid, and I was right there freaking out alongside of them. So
let's go to picture number two. I see the mirror imaging that you have of you, because I see two silhouettes of you. Is this the same being, or this one looks a little different as far as the structure of the face? What is this we're actually looking at?
That is a spirit. That's one way to see them. Okay, if you look directly in the middle, you'll see his eyes, his nose, his mouth. And then you look up a little bit higher, you'll see another image of a being. Eyes, nose, and mouth. But there's also one other image. You gotta bring the two sides closer together, and you'll see the third and final image. Heaven, the spiritual world sometimes works on threes. If it's a real image of a spirit, it'll have three factors.
Looking at this image closer, I see it looks like it also can be one particular being with a headdress, because this image looks almost wolf-like.
I know what you mean. That's real. I was taken with my cell phone. All my pictures were taken with my cell phone.
Wow, wow, wow. Let's move on. Second row. First image, second row. This is you standing four Valley corners of area of the United States, four corners area, yeah?
Valley of Fire, Nevada. This is where I'm recorded holding my arms up on a petroglyph that's 10,000 years old with the other hikers. We were hand in hand. I was singled out. I basically was on top of that rock with my hands held high. I had a spirit inside of me. I was kind of like possessed, you could say. This was 10,000 years ago, and the elders were very, very strong spiritually. So that's all they did all day long and night, was practice stuff spiritually.
So you're the glyph all the way to the left, the little one with the arms up. What are these others? The two to the left almost look like robots, and I see that they're holding hands. But what are those two, the bigger ones?
The one at the very last is called Prophecy Rock. That's the Hopi's Prophecy Rock. That's in Arizona. Actually, people don't know, but you can also see in my pictures that I'm pointing it out, that you'll see them in the second to the last picture, they're hand in hand, and to the very last picture, they're hand in hand. Those are the same people in two different locations. The first picture in the same row is where I'm standing up, and you see me holding my arms up, that's me as a little kid. That's me on Prophecy Rock.
Okay.
That's me on the petroglyphs.
So look at, back to image number one and row number two. My question, let me rephrase that. Looking at that particular picture, there are two images, and they look to be fatter, bigger, wider than the other two. What are those two things right there?
You mean on the second row?
The second row, the first picture that you're standing by that rock, I see your little image, but what are the other two big ones?
Those are elders, and we're hand in hand. Those are the other hikers.
So what is the fourth image, the second one from the right, which is bright orange, fiery red kind of thing? It's like all these different glyphs. Do you know what all this means?
Yeah, that's the hikers. They went to the people. They had many deer. Not deer, but they had many rams. Because there's a time scale from when the season was. And we asked for help. We were hand in hand. We were travelers. And one of us was remembered as dying. That was me. And you can see my spirit with the little symbols, like a little, there's like a little cross there. And that's me.
So the last image on that row is an actual picture, petroglyph of you and the others coming out of the craft. Is that correct, sir?
No, that's Prophecy Rock. The very last picture on second row, that's Prophecy Rock. That's with Masao. That's me under Masao. And those are the other hikers, hand in hand. Same thing. Same people, same group of people, just a different location.
It looks like you're standing on a walkway or some sort of ramp.
I was given a name a long time ago, thousands of years ago. I'm on Prophecy Rock. I'm on petroglyphs.
Is that something you can share?
I was with the extraterrestrials. I'm Pahana. That's why you're seeing all this. You're not going to see this from any other white man on Earth. Face it. This is it. This is who I am. This is what has happened. This is what has been happening to me. And I somehow got to figure out a way to get some help from somebody. Let's go to the Hopi tribe in Arizona and let's go get the aliens, the extraterrestrials technology that I hid. We'll tell them everything. They'll probably remember. They'll be like, well, why didn't you come to us sooner? I'll be like, because I was stuck and I had asked for help and no one would help me. I'm basically going to tell the truth the whole way through because I know I've already been in heaven and I'm not going to lie about nothing. This is the truth. You can see my pictures are proof. I mean, how many people do you know of have pictures of themselves in heaven? Nobody.
Yeah, yeah. These pictures are pretty amazing, bro.
I've really got pictures of themselves with extraterrestrials and very evil spirits and very powerful spirits. Nobody. Me. I'm the guy.
Let's go to the third row, Kenneth, and we have quite a few pictures, and I think the pictures tell a lot of the story. And, bro, I want to say I appreciate your courage, seriously, because, one, coming out with kind of things, you know, you're subjected to ridicule. People who come out with such information are subjected to other people wanting to squash it. So I applaud that, bro. Third row, let's give some detail, but also keep in mind we got a lot of images to go through. What is it we're looking at in the third row?
You see that lady right there pointing? There's another picture that's on the fourth row that's at the very end of the fourth row. That's me. She's pointing at me on my older self on the ground. Next to the lady in heaven, sticking out of the cloud a little bit, is me. That's me. She's pulling me and says, look, you're alive on the ground. You're in the future. You're alive. Right above her head, you can see an image of my face. That's 1, 2, 3. That's real. Taking with my cell phone. Me in heaven. Me in heaven. Me on Earth at the same time.
As I'm looking at this picture, it's amazing that most of the cloud formation is bluish, grayish. But this one image that you're speaking of, this woman, it is just pure snow white.
Yep. Yep, that's somebody. That's somebody right there. She's pointing. You can even see her, excuse my language, you can even see her boobies.
Cloud boobies. All right, now let's move to the next picture. Picture number 2 on row 3. What are we looking at, bro?
Actually, I'm looking at it and all I see is a white. It's white out. Oh, there it is. Oh, okay. I see. I got it. That is the same picture.
Same image, yeah. Yeah.
Of the top on number 1. It's just brought in a little closer.
Yep. Now the third image really has my attention. It's
that's
what
very,
is that?
Very bad. That's very, very, you can basically see what that is. Now I want to hear it from you first before I tell you anything.
Go ahead. It looks ominous and gloomy. That's for sure.
Yeah. Tell me, what do you think it looks like? Go ahead.
Give me a moment. I mean, let me intuit, but also take it in. Give me a second.
First letter starts with an S.
Well, if you're referring to Satan, I don't know. Fake. No. Okay. I give. But what I feel from the picture is dark. Absolutely.
Yeah. That looks like to me, because it looks like a snake, but it also looks like a gray. So.
Wow.
And then, yep.
Is this the same? The next picture, is this the same as the one before, or is this a completely different energy entity?
That's a completely different picture. The fourth picture on the third row, you can see the entity right in the middle, right above.
And again, this is you just using your cell phone, snapping it, and mirroring the image.
Actually, what it is on the side of each image is the same thing you can make out of face. That's actually me.
How did you come to the awareness to do this? Was it just a fanciful idea that popped into your head? Let me try this and see what happens. Or no. Did you feel prompted?
I was led to do these things spiritually. You know, it's not the right time. It's the right time to go out there. Basically, go out there, take your camera, Kenny, and take a picture. Go. And all right, go. And take a picture, and boom, there you go.
All right, let's move on. What's the next one? It's dark. Just because it's dark doesn't always imply doom and gloom. But what is this next one that we're looking at?
It has wings. It doesn't have a face. It doesn't look good, does it?
It's beautiful to look at, but it doesn't mean the intention of it is.
Yeah, I know. But it has wings. And basically, it's from picture number one, top row. Well, I'll tell the secret at the end of this broadcast.
Good deal. Out of all the pictures that I'm looking at, one of them, there's a three or four that really, they all are pretty wowing to me. But the first picture on row number four is pretty defined, pretty detailed. That one doesn't quite blow up. In fact, it's bigger if you just leave it as it is on the page. This clearly looks like someone took a paintbrush and created a being to put on this picture. That's for sure.
Actually, if you go to the fourth picture, I mean the fourth row, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the last picture on fourth row, that picture came from there. Of me in heaven and me on earth at the same time. Now, what you don't know is, let me see. Right, a little bit to the right of that picture, you'll see an arm and a leg, and you'll see a face right next to my hair on the right side. And if I was to mirror image that right there, you would not only see the alien right there, but you would also see something. Boom! It's a lot of stuff. Man, is a lot of stuff.
I can see in the second image on the fourth row. I'm guessing. I'm assuming. I'm intuiting that this picture for you is not a happy picture for you at all. In fact, it looks like there's a lot of emotional pain involved in this image.
Yeah. That picture goes with Prophecy Rock. There was a legend about a long time ago told by one of the elders who was a prophet who actually made Prophecy Rock when we were walking right past him. We were walking right past him when he was, carving Prophecy Rock. He would wear a red shirt. He would both be up in heaven and on earth at the same time. And he would have Masao with the picture with Masao. Well, there you go.
Wow. So, Kenny, do you think when you were taken, I mean, I know you were taken physically, but do you think there was still a physical you left behind and they somewhat took your essence? I mean, any thoughts about that? Because you said you were in heaven and earth at the same time. So I'm trying to, divide you up, so to speak, so I can understand how were you bilocated in these places?
Basically, I got turned into, I was also in ceremony and rituals thousands of years ago. I was made that way by the elders.
because I was in heaven on earth at the same time. I was basically a walking spirit, a kachina, you can say.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So what is this third image we're looking at, sir, on the fourth row? It's a split image.
If you go to the first row, the second image, remember I said they work in threes sometimes?
Yes.
That's the end result, the third. That's brought closer together. And there you go. There's the bigger spirit right there.
Is this one friendly or not?
I don't know. But I'm still here.
I notice when you speak about this particular not good being, you call it him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And these next two images are basically just you doing a sky selfie. And what is happening to the next picture behind you on the fourth row, the fourth picture?
That's a great spirit. You can see his eyes, nose, and his mouth. That was taken outside of a public library here in town. So was the last picture. A lot of these
pictures. Oh, wow. I can see it so clear.
Yeah.
Wow.
Surprise, it's real.
Yeah, I see his left eye, his nostrils, and his mouth very clearly. Yeah. Wow. Let's keep moving forward, brother. This next picture, the last picture on the fourth row.
That's me in heaven, me on earth at the same time. You can. That's the same picture as in picture number three on the third row. Picture number one on the third row.
Yeah, I see the lady now. Yes,
that's just me. You know, I had my cell phone and I took a picture of myself in heaven. If you look on row five, it's also the same. It's also the first three pictures are the same thing. It's just different lighting, so you guys can actually really see what's going on with me. Okay.
Have you ever tried turning these into negatives to see what might pop out?
I don't got the technology to do that. I'd have to really trust somebody with my pictures, you know. You won't see stuff like this from anybody, you know. This is real. This has to deal with the spirit world, and it's a lot more than people can conceive of, comprehend, or even imagine. This is real, legit stuff. This is big boy stuff. This ain't little, I'm going to write a book stuff. This is, here's the proof, facts stuff.
You know, Kenneth, if you so desire, and if you trust me, if you want to intuit 5, 6, 8 pictures that you feel led that might have something reveal itself, if I was to make these into negatives for you, tell me what those images are. Actually, just send them to me. I'll go into my Photoshop and I'll make these into negatives. In fact, I won't even look at them. I'll make them into the negatives and use a very non-penetrating eye, and I will send them to you. And because I would like you to interpret what you think might be there so you can educate me as the picture or the image might reveal itself to be. That's up to you. And you can tell me that off the air or not. It's really up to you, bro. Let's keep moving forward. So I'm seeing more selfies of you on row 5. Same ideas. Images are appearing. What is this on row number 5, the second to last picture, the second picture from the end, which looks like there's a heart in the sky? Is that what that is?
That's actually a great spirit. That's the great ram, the great cat, me in heaven. That's called a kachina. That's a kachina. A kachina, kachina, same thing. The last picture, oh man. That was me sitting outside in front of the public library, sitting outside in front of the window. I had my cell phone. I decided to take a picture, and sure enough, there was a spirit over me. And, well, I had to make sure, and sure enough, I double imaged it, and there it is right there. You see him right in the middle.
Kenneth, I'm going to throw something at you, bro, that's going to seem kind of wild. And not for you. That can't be wild. How about I'm going to throw a wild idea at you. Now, we're looking at these pictures, which are you with malevolent and benevolent beings both, who are making, quote, appearances in your life or being revealed. And the fact, metaphorically, maybe purposefully, that this mirror imaging that's happening, this split that's happening, you in heaven, you on earth, could be what you said it was at the beginning, this great transformation that happened for you. The two parts of the whole self, which has been split, the positive and negative polarities that lives in everyone, that's in everything in the world of duality. Do you think that some part of your wholeness is coming together in a cosmic way? But let me finish the question. I know it's a long question because I'm channeling and I'm trying to find the right words of what I'm trying to ask you. You talked about that there was a war in heaven. Is this war over your soul?
Basically, whoever goes to heaven, there's going to be a war over your soul. There's good and bad up there. You know, it's not all what they make it up to be. There's good and bad up in heaven, and it's in the clouds. That's the spirit world, really, really big for people who don't know that. But what has happened to me is you can see a great transcendence happen. You can see me in heaven. You can see me with many spirits. It's all real. I not only proved that time travel is real. I proved that heaven's real. I proved that extraterrestrials are real. And I was just a kid. And I've been going through this my whole life. And my message is for humanity is we are all brothers and sisters. There are no lines dividing us from helping one another in friendship, kindness, peace, love, joy, respect. We have many different colored painted hands. We live on many different colored painted lands, you know. But we're all here. We're all one big family. Things happen to people all the time, and no one helps no more. Not like they did thousands of years ago. I know I was back in time thousands of years ago. In a sense, I've always been here for many thousands of years. I see your point.
Absolutely. I see your point.
You guys grow. You guys are stupid, dangerous animals today. You're very stupid. You lost a lot of stuff. My elders used to talk to each other with their minds without even moving their mouths. And they could talk to me with my implants, and I could talk to them or with body language. But man, you guys really changed a lot. You're dumb, stupid, dangerous animals.
Mm.
Yeah, I know it, and you guys know it. Now, come on. Help me out. Let's figure this out. Let's do the right thing. That's all I want to do is the right things, not just for myself, but for everybody. I did something that was pretty darn wrong and stupid, and all I want to do is the right things and make it better, because you can see I'm being hounded.
Are you still taking these sky selfies?
No, I haven't done it in a while. I've been keeping my hat on, if you know what I mean.
Well, I can understand that, brother, because the looks of this last picture on row 5, I mean, it looks like you're sweating, you're nervous. And even though you didn't know what was going to come out on that picture until you looked at it, just your disposition in it, the whole image looks pretty dark. Not you and not your disposition of how you treat people in the world, but just, you know, you feel bound.
Yeah. Well, if this would happen to you, you'd be scared crapless, you know? You wouldn't know what to think or what to do. I mean, this, you know, you gotta imagine this happened to a little kid too, you know? And I wanna go to the sixth row.
Yeah, by all means, let's go. What is the first image we're looking at on row number 6?
That's me in an underground cave standing right in front of an extraterrestrial.
Is he in the light?
Yes.
Yeah, obviously that's you. So that image is an extraterrestrial.
You can see that there's light in an underground cave.
How did you take this picture? Did you happen to have your phone with you when the craft was on the ground?
I had my cell phone in my back pocket.
Was this an Earth visitation, or what is this? How did this happen?
That's an abduction. I had my cell phone in my back pocket, and I tried like heck to take that picture. I was partially numb, which you could say incoherent. What do you mean? You know, I could see. It's just I couldn't sense really what was around me that much. And all I remember is, I was allowed to take this picture. Get your cell phone out of your pocket, take the picture. And I smiled and I took the picture. So you can see the stalactites and stalagmites in the underground cave.
So what is the light source?
I have no idea.
That's an honest answer, that's for sure. And this, as we get towards the end of this picture viewing, this is the age you were when you went to this camp and you were removed from this time and brought back.
Yep, that's me.
Was this picture taken before and you just revealing about how old you were, or was this picture taken after you were brought back? Or do you know? Does it matter?
The end picture was taken after we were brought back. You can see my hair is longer. My clothes didn't even fit. A couple inches. I must have grown a couple inches because my mom had to take me out and get me new clothes and a haircut.
Kenneth, we are coming to the top of this broadcast, bro. You said you wanted to leave us with a secret. We only have actually 2 minutes, so give us your final statement, and hopefully that could be mixed with this secret. And I really appreciate you being here, bro, and the courage you have. You have my applause, sir.
Thanks. They are here. They've always been here. They are time travelers. They've been traveling through time. Also, I have proof that the Nazis were also back in time. They also had a craft, and they were chasing, hunting after us. The Hopi also recorded them on petroglyphs. Now, I have all the proof of this. I have all the proof of everything. As you can see from my pictures, I'm not lying about anything. Well, I don't need to. It's a lot scarier than you think. I worry about what's going to happen to me whenever that one day happens. I want the extraterrestrials to know that I want them to come take me and the military and to help me and to the Hopi, bring me to the Hopi. And let's sit down and let's really figure this out and let's get to the bottom of this and let's do the right things. You got a little kid who needs help and he's a good kid. And it's just now that I'm older and I'm still kind of screwed up about this, you know. People don't have proof like this, and I do.
Kenneth, thank you for being a powerful guest for me on Center of Light Radio. I didn't know this much of the story when you and I first spoke, and I appreciate you sharing it, brother. I really, really do. Thank you.
All right, man.
Be well, my friend. I'll be in touch with you soon. Everyone, what a phenomenal show. You know, before we go into putting ourselves in closed boxes, this might be some very powerful information for the future of humanity, meaning you have that file open, and so you might know how to respond when something of this magnitude happens, or when we might need the simple information that Kenneth is imparting here today. Keith Anthony Blanchard, Center of Light Radio, your host, 6 p.m. Eastern Time on Monday nights. I am here. Always remember peace, love, and light. And make sure you check out the centeroflightradio.com website and sign up for that newsletter program. Peace out. Inside.